you. It's a really a pleasure for me to be here. I always look forward to showing people some of the work that I do. My goal today, I don't know if I actually titled this correctly, how to obtain images of very tiny things, because there's actually a couple of disclaimers here. One, I should just title this, some ways of taking pictures of tiny things, because there's so many ways. And the other thing I should maybe say is how to obtain images of insects, because all I'm going to show you is how I take pictures of bugs. I thought about maybe taking some pictures of other little tiny things just to make this a little bit more broad. And I tried taking some pictures of some gems, and I took some pictures of coins, and I took some pictures of electronic circuits, and they sucked. And I said, I'll stick with insects. Sorry, for those of you that are macro photographers, the disclaimer is I've been doing this for 4 years, so I have a lot to learn still about this macro photography. So we can say this is a report on what I've been doing for the last 4 years. So some of you macro guys may not learn anything today about macro photography, but you will learn about bugs a lot. Motivation for me to do this is because when I was very tiny, I just loved to chase bugs. My daughter drew these little graphics of me when I was a young man, chasing bugs. I didn't have a camera. So I just captured the insects, took a look at them, and released them. And amazingly, some of those images of some of those insects that I captured when I was a little tiny guy are still in my mind. Nowadays, I do have a camera. And I go out and take pictures of bugs, and now these images are in JPEGs and are published in Flickr. What I'm going to try to talk about, report today, is for those of you who are beginners or in the concept of magnification. So I'm going to talk a little bit about magnification. And then after that, once we have some of those fundamentals out of the way, I'm going to talk a little bit about my gear, my camera, my lens, my lights, etc. And then I'm going to talk about some other things that I have done in the past. I actually didn't put them here, but I'm going to give an example of maybe a focus stacking technique. And if there's time and if there's interest, I may even show something regarding what I'm calling a macro panorama. And I'll show you in a little bit what that means. All right. So, if it wasn't for my passion for insects, I probably would not even have a camera. When I go with my wife on trips, I'm not the one who takes the pictures. My wife is the one who takes the pictures. I only have a micro lens. Well, I do have the kit lens that came with my D90, but I don't use it. So I've learned a lot of challenges about taking pictures of insects, little insects, tiny insects, and I have been forced to learn something about macro photography to be able to get the best pictures of these little tiny beasts that I can. I'm going to go through some slides that show some of the challenges of taking pictures of tiny insects, tiny things, and I'm sure that a lot of these challenges apply to other small things that you may be interested in. This is a leaf hopper. I told you the macro guys are going to learn something about insects. This is a leaf hopper, and he's about 3 or 4 millimeters long. Insects move a lot. They fly a lot, so it's really hard to get a good picture of them. This is an amazing picture, and you wonder how I did this. Luck. L-U-C-K. Turns out that's the first day that I went out in my backyard to take a picture with my 60 millimeter macro lens that I was testing out before I bought it. And I saw this little fly standing on a leaf. Got my flash, set my camera, shot, and the flash went choo. And that little fly jumped. And then when I looked at the picture, there was no fly in the leaf. So what happened? It was in the corner of the image. And that's what I got. It came back to the same leaf, and I repeated the shot, and he jumped again. So he gets scared by the flash, and that's what happens. I took a lot of pictures of this fly, and only this one came out good. They hide. This one did a poor job of trying to hide, but they hide. And that's another challenge of taking pictures of insects. By the way, some of these challenges, I'm sorry, they really don't have to do with photography, but, you know, it's, I guess, well, for us photographers, perseverance maybe is a lesson to be learned here. When you approach insects, the first thing they do is they're going to try to fly away. They blend in. This is a caterpillar. The thing is, now I'm trained to look for things that blend in. Most people would just walk by this thing and not even know it's there. And sometimes they look like something else. This is a stick insect. There's a stick insect there. Again, very hard to see. This is from South America. By the way, a lot of pictures I take are from insects of South America. I'm actually trying to specialize on insects of South America. Talk a little bit more about that in a minute. Some insects are really hard to get to. They live in the water. And in this particular image, it's a tough image to look at, but there's a fly larvae, which is the thing that looks like it's wiggling around, it's turned around, with the two air sacs in the posterior end. There's a mosquito larvae on the left side of the image. And that cotton-looking thing in the center is actually a what they call a springtail that walks on the surface of the water. So this is a kiddie pool that I bought from Kmart, filled it up with water and stuck it in the backyard and to capture aquatic insects. It was approved by my wife. She let me do this in the back. She also approves of me keeping some insects in the freezer that I use for studio photography. Insects shine, some of them. And maybe some of you can give me some ideas on how to take pictures of shiny things in flight. The background of this picture is actually my shirt. This is in the Amazon basin. My wife and I went down there, hired a guide to bring us into the jungle to try to catch pictures of neat insects. And the guide had this bright idea that he had this chemical that would attract bees. The problem is the chemical spilled in my shirt. So this fly, this bee is hovering over my chest. So I'm trying to take the picture like real close. Yeah, in my backyard sometimes the mosquitoes are really bad and they bite. Oh, I think I told you this before in my last presentation. This is actually a mosquito that landed in my right hand when I was trying to take a picture. So then I moved my camera to the left hand, put my right hand in front of the camera, and moved my hand up and down to focus. I'm pretty proud of these pictures, even though their quality is not great. I'm impressed because some insects are really hard to find at the right time. This, in the left side, is a whole view of what they call a lacewing egg. Not many of you know what a lacewing is, but it's a little predator in gardens that eat bad insects, so they're good actually. That's the egg of the lacewing. It actually, this is glued to the window of my door to the deck. The egg part itself is about 1 millimeter in length. This is a handheld picture with a bunch of extension tubes, and I'll show you the setup I used to take this picture. It's fairly okay in focus, it's not perfect, but it was in the corner, so there's no way for me to put a tripod or anything, so I had to do it handheld. And I had to keep monitoring these eggs because I wanted to catch the thing when it came out of the egg. On the right side, you may see a dark spot at the bottom of the egg. That's the eye of the developing insect. And there it is. It just came out of the egg on the left side, and then it runs down the stalk and goes away. The right side is a 1.5 millimeter insect running around like crazy, and me trying to shoot as many images of that thing as I can. And some insects live for just a few hours. So it's another one of those lucky things if you can get a picture of it. These are the so-called mayflies that only have hours of life in span. All they do is mate. They don't eat. They come out as adults, they mate, and then die. What a life, huh? All right, so now I'll have to talk a little bit about microphotography and magnification and so forth. So it's not the same thing to take a picture of an elephant than take a picture of a fly. This is a picture of my dinner plate one afternoon as I was having dinner with my wife. My plate's empty. Is the purple and blue background, that's my plate. There's no photoshopping or anything done here. And that fly landed on my plate to lick whatever was left over. I ran in, grabbed the camera, came back out, and shot a few pictures of it. It's about 10 millimeters long. So, what is microphotography? It is when the size of the image on your sensor is the same size as the object or greater. Let me ask you something. How many of you, please raise your hand, how many of you know what the dimension of your sensor is on your camera? Raise your hand. In millimeters. Okay, that's fine, that's all right. Okay, so how many of you knows what's required to take a picture? Raise your hand. Shy people, okay. Well, this is my version of what's required. First of all, you gotta have a place to record the image. In the old days, it used to be the 35 millimeter film, or, I mean, some people still use that. Nowadays, it's a digital sensor. It's an electronic piece of hardware. It's inside your camera. And the image gets recorded there. What else do we need? We need a subject. For me, the subject is an insect always, or almost always. And I want that insect to look as big as possible within that image sensor, gets best resolution. I need a lens. In my case, a macro lens. And I'll talk to you about a macro lens a little bit later. And of course, the subject. I'm missing something. What am I missing?
Camera. Light.
Light, exactly. Yeah, I'm assuming the camera is in there somewhere. So, if the image has a size equal to the subject, in this case, and that's what I try to draw here, then that's macrophotography. Now, this is a fancy image that I found on Wikipedia about macrophotography. Looks very complicated, but all it's saying is that if we define magnification as beta, thing that looks like a B, and it's between 1 and 25, then we can consider that magnification. Beta being how big the image is related to the subject. So then I did a little bit more research online. I found some additional definitions. If you're working anywhere between 1 to 20 and 1 to 1, you can call it close-up. So in fact, a lot of the photography that I do is really close-up photography, not microphotography, because the insects are too big to fit in my image sensor. So I have to do something to my lens so that the insect feels the sensor. Now, if I get into the 1-to-1 ratio to about 25-to-1 ratio, some people say that's macrophotography. And beyond that, some people define that as microscopy. Now you're taking stuff of really, really tiny, tiny stuff. If I use these definitions then, close-up photography, I can take something in size that is 200 millimeters to 25 millimeters. If the subject is somewhere between 25 millimeters and 1 millimeter, then I can say it's microphotography. Beyond that, microphotography. So for those of you that need a little review on dimensions, you know, I'm gonna be talking a lot about millimeters. So let me just quickly throw in this conversion factors here. 1 inch is equal to 2.5 centimeters, which is equal to 25.4 millimeters. 1 centimeter is equal to 10 millimeters. This is metric. I mean, photographers for the most part are aware of this because the lenses are all designed in metric, but some people don't really pay attention to this a lot. 100 centimeters is equal to 1 meter, which is equal, in 1,000 meters is equal to 1 kilometer. And finally, 1 millimeter is equal to 1,000 microns, and a micron is the same as a micrometer. All right, so I made this table just to get a relation of where we are in terms of photography, different sizes of subjects. Maybe some of you take pictures of the moon. I've never taken a picture of the moon. Maybe some of you have gone to the zoo and taken a picture of an elephant. I take pictures of flies, as you know. And some people take pictures of bacteria. There's a bacteria called E. coli that we all hear about in the news sometimes. Well, how big are these things? Well, the moon has a diameter of about 3,500 kilometers. Big, but it's far away, 300,000 kilometers away. So to be able to field your sensor in your camera with the moon, you need some fancy lenses. You may need a telescope or some really serious zoom lens. I'm not a zoom lens guy, you know, so you tell me, oh, I have a 400 millimeter zoom lens. I'm like, okay, great, you know, but I'm suspecting you need a pretty serious big lens to get a picture of the moon to field your sensor. Elephant, you can, depending on how far you are from the elephant, you can use your prime or a zoom lens. For a fly, which is 10 millimeters, then use the micro lens. And for a bacteria, which is 2 microns, I'm going to give you an idea of what 2 microns is in a minute. You need some serious microscope now, not just any microscope. You need some expensive microscope to feel the image of your sensor. I mean, I was talking to my wife, who's a biologist and microbiologist, and I asked her, honey, can you see a E. coli with a microscope? And she said, yes. But hard. I mean, you really, to be able to feel the image of your sensor, you need some serious magnification. Anyway, hope these dimensions help to get an idea of what we're talking about. I know what the size of my sensor is. I learned that because that helps me improve my microphotography. My sensor is 24 millimeters long, and it's a 16 million pixels sensor, 16 megapixels, on my Nikon D7000. Now you all go home and find out what the size of your sensors are, right? I expand it. Just for the sake of showing you this, I took a little area of the butterfly picture and I expanded it so I could see the pixels. And knowing the number of pixels on the side of my sensor and knowing how long my sensor is, I can calculate how big is each pixel. Each pixel in my D7000 is 5 microns, about. So that means that even within one of those pixels, I could fit about 2 E. coli bacteria. That gives you an idea. So certainly I won't be able to take pictures of E. coli. Okay, close up. Another way of looking at this real quick. I have a ruler there. And remember, the rectangle is my image sensor. Which is 23.6 millimeters, but let's just say 24 millimeters for simplicity. My ruler there is 24 millimeters too. So that ruler is the same length as my sensor. But in the image here, it's only taking half of my field. That's a close-up because the ruler looks smaller than the actual size of the image sensor. That's what my fly would look. That's a 10 millimeter fly. I would look if I had my camera adjusted to that field. Now, this is my setup, and I'm going to show you actually go through all the components here. This is my studio setup that I use to take pictures. And that's shown there is my 60 millimeter macro lens fully extended. When it's fully extended, then the magnification is 1:1, or close thereabouts. It actually turns out that, and I don't know what is the variability, but I bought another D7000 and another 60 millimeter lens, same models, identical, for a job that I did in South America. And when I try to measure the 1:1 magnification, or not the maximum magnification, they were different by a millimeter or so. So there's variability even within the same model. I don't know if it's the lens or what it was. 1:1 now, this is another way of looking at it, is when the 24 millimeter ruler fits exactly on the 24 millimeter digital sensor, 1:1. And that's how my fly would look. I want more magnification. So if you want to add magnification to your setup, there's this gadget called extension tubes. I'll show you the extension tubes later. They increase magnification. So I added 3 extension tubes there. That's what it looks like now. I got about a 1 to 2.3 magnification. And that's how my fly looks. I want more magnification. And in this case, I found a way to include a microscope objective to my Nikon D7000. And I'll show you how to do that in a minute. And that's how you do it. So it's on the record. It's actually not that expensive. It's all relative, right? But we'll talk about that later also. And that's what it looks like now. So now I'm getting really close to my insect. There's issues with this. Might as well go ahead and record it. The higher the magnification, the field of depth, the field of depth that you have deteriorates significantly. So when I have 10 magnification and I'm using the microscope objective, I can't do photography in the field anymore. It has to be completely still. Vibration is my enemy. And also the depth of field is so shallow that now I have to use a technique called focus stack. And I just have to do, I'll show you how to do that later. This is a picture that I took with the microscope objective using focus stacking technique. This is one of the first ones I did. It's good, but it's got a lot of issues with it. I've been doing research online of people who do this, and the images they have are absolutely superb. I'm far from being a focus stack expert. However, on the other hand, I don't need to be, because really, I want to have the capability to do this, but I'm not trying to perfect this technique. I just want to be able to, in some cases, take pictures of very small insects. So I actually spend a very, very small portion of my time doing this kind of work. But I want to be able to know how to do it, and be able to do it if necessary.
Do you recall how many you stacked for that?
Since this one's one of the first, not more than 30 or 40.
That's a lot, yeah.
Well, some of the really, really, really good pictures online, if you go to my Flickr and Tomopixel account, I have a gallery of focus stacking, and I have a gallery because it's stuff I can't do, someday I want to be able to do. And those guys, when they do a focus stack, they're looking at 200 pictures. Now, to do 200 pictures focus stack, you're moving in extremely small increments, and you need automation. And as a matter of fact, I'm an electronics engineer as well. Part of my business of Entomopixel is going to be to develop a series of automated controllers to do this kind of work. So we have a prototype. I wanted to bring it today. Wasn't quite ready. Next time. You know, light is so critical to this business. No matter what kind of photography you do, light is one of the most challenging aspects of photography. It's no different for the macro photographer, and I'll show you a few things I do for light later on. Okay, so that's it for the slides for now. I have a few more slides later, but now I think what I'm going to do is actually go over some of the stuff that I have here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn the light on a little bit. Okay, all my toys here. This is my D7000. It's connected to the computer because later on I'm going to show some things on the screen through the computer. Hopefully it'll work. This is a Nikon D7000. Why Nikon? It's a long story. I don't have time to tell you why. There's many, many cameras that will do a good job for macro photography. But one of the things about this camera that I like for macro is the noise level of those pixels. Remember I talked about those individual pixels? Well, those pixels are electronic devices. And all electronic devices have what they call noise floor levels. What is the minimum amount of noise that that thing is going to produce even when no light is coming in? That pixel is still going to record something. So Nikon has one of the best noise specifications out there. So you can actually crop the picture a lot and still look very, very decent. The other thing about the D7000, it's not like I'm trying to do a sales pitch here, but it's one of the reasons why I bought this thing. I had a D90 before I had the D7000. If you open up over here, it's got two SD slots. Fabulous, because I traveled far with a guide that was very expensive. When I got to my location where I was going to take pictures of bugs with my D90, I had no card in the slot.
Oh, I love that.
Two slots. Good. One improvement on the D7000 over the D90 that I loved is when you pop up the flash and you extend. This is the macro lens. And you extend the macro lens to 1:1. That flash will illuminate the bug. The bug's going to be over here. We'll see that. And it's not going to make a shadow because of the lens. The D90 does make a shadow. So that was a great. And the other thing is, this flash syncs at 1 over 320 seconds, which is a little bit better than the Nikon D90, which synced at 1 over 200 seconds. So it gives me a little bit more ability to capture the insect at night or during the day or whatever in without movement. So those are the kind of three things that I like about this camera. My macro lens is old. It's the only macro lens I've had in a long time, or the only one I had. I've been told that I need a new one and that I could probably get better pictures with a better macro lens, but since I bought all these other toys, I have no money left. But the next thing in the list is that. Now, still though, keep in mind, are you happy with your pictures? I'm happy with my pictures. They're doing what I want them to do. So I can wait. All right. If I want more magnification, one technique is to separate this lens from the camera using the extension tubes. That has the effect of magnifying the image bigger on the sensor. That's the reason why you have those extension tubes. So I went out and got some extension tubes. These are some Kenko extension tubes. There's a 12 millimeter, 20 millimeter, and 36 millimeter extension tubes here. You can separate them if you want, or you can use them all at once. So I'm going to go ahead and put this here.
there any optics in the extension tubes, or are they just literally extension
tubes? Actually, I do that trick, you know, because this is the most expensive lens I have. Ooh, and then I say, oh no, it's really nothing. So it is just a tube. You can. I've seen guys that are, and girls that actually make their own.
Yeah.
Now, I forgot something. Give me a sec. Oh, okay, I got. Does anyone? Did anyone bring fleas with you?
I had a chick earlier.
How about bed bugs? Anybody had bed bugs? Because I'm looking for a model. I want to be taking some pictures, so I need a bug. No? Okay. So I guess I'll use mine here. This is a Colorado potato beetle. It's a mounted one. It's a pest. It eats potatoes. And today it's going to serve as our model. It's in good shape. So, the other thing I want to say, I'm going to disconnect this for now. Let's see what happens. And I want to take some pictures, and then we'll see what they look like. So, maybe some of you are thinking, do I need all that gear to do macro photography? Forget it. I'm wasting my time coming to this show. And the answer is no. All you need is this. 95% or more of my pictures is with this. This stuff is like less than 5% of the stuff that I do. This is it. And the reason for that is because when I go to the jungle, and I'm trying to, I mean, it's hot, and bugs move and move and move. There's no time for me to set up the extension tube, and well, you see the rigs that I can come up with. So I just go with this and shoot away. You know, and I have to get real close. This is about how close I have to get. I have the ISO too high, and the other thing about the Nikon camera, it allows you to set the power of the flash. So I also have the power too high. So I'm going to change that as well. That I know how to do because I do it a lot. It's in full, so I'm going to go to about a quarter. And this is exactly what I do in the field. Those three or four settings, and off I go if the bug's still there. And I'm going to go ahead and do it again. There. That's a lot better.
Usually shoot with your flash on manual?
Yes. Good
take
question.
A shot and then change it.
Yeah. If I do that. Yeah. Now, I'm open to suggestions. But, yeah, that's how I do it. All right. Now, let's say I wanted this bug to look a little bit bigger on my field. So now I'm going to put my extension tubes. Whoa, look at this now. Now, problem with this. These extension tubes actually have the capability to transmit all the signals from the camera to the lens if you want to do autofocus. So those are nice. But for the most part, I've heard that extension tubes, if you stack three of them like this, there's a loss of reliability on those connections. This has little play here. Okay? So I've seen that as a problem. So if I use extension tubes, sometimes I just use two. I haven't had a lot of problem with the two largest ones. When I use the three, sometimes I have a problem. Okay. Now, problem here. If I pop up my flash, now what's my problem?
Shadow.
Okay, so I have to go out. See, the thing is, you buy something to make it better, and then you realize you need something else. Flash head. All right, this flash head's already being extended. It's got a little white flap here. It's got a diffuser. Diffusing light, for me, is a big deal, because insects are so shiny and reflective and this and that. So I fight a lot with the diffusion thing. So I'm going to lock this in place here. I'm going to turn this on. And I want to take a picture. Let's see. How close do I need to get now? Whoa, very close. There. Now, I got a picture. All right, we'll look at these pictures later. You know one thing? For some reason, bug people like to take pictures of the face of the insect. So we're gonna go ahead and do that.
On the extenders, are they just there to get you closer to the bug?
No, they're there to increase the magnification. Okay. So the bug looks bigger on my sensor. The drawback is now I have to get closer to the bug. That's just one of the bad things. Also, depth of field decreases. So for the most part, when I use these extension tubes and I'm handheld like this, I have to take a lot more pictures for any one of them to be good. And you will see that a lot of the stuff I'm doing right now is going to be no good. But I don't have time to take 50 pictures of this beetle right now.
What about using tripods to hold your camera? Because I'm suspecting that it's very susceptible to your handshake too.
Absolutely, and I shake a lot now.
Yeah.
I don't know how much longer I'm going to be able to do this. But the problem with that, setting the tripod, is by the time I set the tripod, the insect is gone. I don't have a tripod. You know, I have thousands and thousands of pictures without tripod. All the work I do is manual in the field. But I do take a lot of crappy pictures.
You mentioned autofocus. Are you successful at getting these pictures using autofocus?
Never. I never use autofocus. The only way I focus is by moving back and forth. That's my focus mechanism. I don't even turn this thing. I don't touch the camera focus at all. All I do is back and forth.
What's your shutter speed?
Right now my shutter speed is 320, 1 over 320. I try to use as fast a shutter speed as I can. Now it turns out that there is like a point of no return, because I also use an f-stop that is the highest I can to improve depth of field. So what happens is, with increased shutter speed, increased F, very little light gets into the camera. But the flash is what's giving me the light, and the flash is only on for like 1/700th of a second. So the flash actually becomes the shutter in some cases. And I haven't really explored all the details of that, but that's how it happens. That's how it happens. All right. So,
ask you one other question. Have you experimented with stacking any handheld shots?
Yes.
Any luck with it?
Moths, because they're flat. Uh-huh. no luck.
Not really?
No.
Yeah.
I haven't had luck. I don't think I have one single good picture of stacking handheld.
You're saying you're shooting at a really high f-stop. What f-stop are you shooting at, normally?
Well, anywhere between 22 and actually 32. I go all the way up to 32, and people say, oh, you start getting a lot of distortion. And, you know, it's probably one of those things that the quality is okay for me. You know, I have some decent pictures. I'm sure that if somebody with a very keen eye is very versed on the technical aspects of an image would think it's got problems. All right. So, light. I decided that I needed even better way to control light. So I bought these remote flashes, and they come. It's a kit from Nike. It comes with all kinds of stuff in there. And you come with this ring. And this ring can actually be picked up over here. This setup gets really ugly really fast.
Yeah.
But it's impressive. I mean, when you go on the field and people see you with this thing, they really think that you know what you're doing. There you go. Look at that.
Oh my God.
Now, what can I do with this? F22 is what I have right now. Now let's turn this on. Let's turn this on
and find the switch.
Now these things eat batteries like crazy, and they're expensive.
Is it like a battery you need to buy, or it's included battery?
It's the battery you buy at the store, is like $8 a piece. Yeah, it's quite expensive. Okay, for this type of flash manipulation, I need to set it on master. So right now I'm just doing it on manual. So I'm gonna go to commander mode. Okay, commander mode is, I believe, it's gonna shoot all these three flashes at once. There's a little bit of shadow from this now. Let's see what happens.
Let's get close to this beetle.
Now, as you can see, one of the reasons why I don't use this rig too much is because now I cannot get into the bushes. Or if I approach the insect and one of those flashes touches one of the leaves, it scares the insect. All right. Got something. All right, so that's this rig. Okay. I'm going to turn this off. Any questions about this? Easy questions, please.
When you're using that much flash, I mean, how much what you actually see correlates? You know, because it seems like you're, like the image that you're seeing through the before the flashes go off would have almost nothing to do with the actual captured image because of the brightness of the object.
Are you saying that all the light may distort the image?
Not necessarily distorted, but just look completely different from what you're actually...
Yeah, that's the whole, you know, I don't know a lot about color reproduction and all those things, but my empirical experience is yes. The type of light you use obviously is going to have an impact on how the color of the insect is reproduced. Yeah. I was telling in the presentation that I did before that, in fact, there's some insects, depending on the angle that you're shooting, they're going to look completely different color because they're iridescent. I mean, I can spend a whole session on just that aspect of this photography. The morpho butterfly is an iridescent butterfly. And I didn't get those pictures for this presentation, but I have some pictures that I actually used, and I took pictures of different angles of the same butterfly, completely different color on the wings. Does that answer the question?
Yeah.
So then, the other thing that happens is, and I'm not going to get a lot into this in this presentation, but the other thing that happens is that you develop the picture on the computer, and now you have Photoshop and other ways of changing a little bit or adjusting the color or making it look a little bit more like you want it to look. I don't think that I change color when I manipulate the pictures afterwards, but I may change the contrast, increase the light, the exposure, things of that nature I use Lightroom, I think it's 3, Lightroom 3 I use, just to adjust a little bit the image. I don't really do a lot of manipulation, I don't know how to. I was also saying before that in some cases, if I want to do something complicated with the picture afterwards, I just send the picture to my daughter, who's a graphics design artist at Campbell University. And I was also saying that in some cases, I may take a picture of this beautiful butterfly, and it's got a broken wing. And it looks all lousy. Well, my daughter can actually reproduce the wing and make it look like it's in perfect shape. Okay. So, I hardly use, let me take this off. We're done with the extension tubes. Now I'm gonna put this guy on. And again, this will give you a totally different aspect of the lighting. And perhaps we'll see when we look at the pictures that I just took, the difference in some of these. If we remember how we took them. Now, notice there's a lot of electrical tape on this ring flash. That it's pretty badly rigged up. This is a personal preference. I just don't, when I take pictures of insects, what happens is the reflection of the ring shows on the eyes of the insect, and I don't like that. So I cover most of the ring flash, so only two spots actually produce the light, almost reproducing the speed lights, one in each side. But there's advantages to the ring flash. Right. Something came out. All right.
How will that rig differ from just using the two, the other two flashes on the end of your?
This is, I think, gives me a more smooth line on the insect.
Uh-huh.
Also allows me to get into narrower places.
It's just smaller. Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
Softer.
It gives me different lighting, but I have not analyzed it.
Uh-huh.
In some cases it looks great, in some cases it doesn't.
Yeah. All right, yeah, I gotta show you one thing. Last thing about light, before I go on showing some more gadgets.
At the speed and the aperture that you're shooting, if your flash doesn't fire, the image will come out blank, right? It will be black.
Yeah.
So yeah. So like 100% of the light that you are using is the flash.
Yes, yes. Sometimes I do open up the f-stop if I want a little bit of the background to show up. Like there's maybe some nice greenery in the back or something like that. Then I can make that effect happen. All right. The one last thing I want to show about light. Oh yeah, so these lights, they're very bright. And so Nikon actually gives you these diffusers that you can somehow hook in there. I think I did it once and I just didn't like the way it worked. I made my own. These are made out of paper. And they work great. Okay, so diffusing light. This is one of my favorite diffusers. It's a bottle of vitamin C. Free. And it fits sort of nice in there.
So when you're outside, you are using flashes?
Yes, I use flash 99% of the time.
Okay.
I use some type of flash.
Mm-hmm.
There's people that take pictures of insects and they do macro without flash. It can be done. I mean, people that take pictures of flowers, I know they can do it a lot without flash.
Mm-hmm.
For me, I want to capture the insect. I want to get a record of it, and not using the flash just is a lot of trouble for me. Blurry and this and that. I haven't had a lot of luck not using the flash. I do have a few pictures, decent pictures without flash, but not many.
But flash is working when it's like 250
The flash, I think the flash mean? Works at any speed up to a certain shutter speed. In the D9, in the D90, it was up to 1 over 200 seconds.
Okay.
On the D7000, it's up to 1 over 320.
320. Okay, so you're using 320 right now.
Well, there's another mode. Maybe some expert knows. There's another mode that allows you to set the camera in such a way that you can do the flash at any speed of shutter. So I think I've done something like 1/1000 with flash. I want to take a picture of this beetle with this thing, and we'll see how it looks like. Now, the thing about using this diffuser is that it takes out a lot of light. So I have to, typically what I do is I just crank up the ISO to 400. So that's the diffuser. Now,
couple of other things that I've got before I get into the other lenses, before I move on, is this thing that I found. Oh, they sell these adapters. They're basically just magnifying lenses. And they screw to the front of the macro lens. They buy you a little bit, not much. I hardly ever use them. I bought them because I wanted to try them. So, but just wanted to keep people to know that they're out there. And they have different magnifications. They call them diopters. I'm not really sure why they call them diopters in terms of the specifications of the magnification. Okay, that's that. I hardly ever use these anymore. And there's this gadget that I got, which is it's decent, but the glass is not that good, so it deteriorates the image a little bit. This is another magnifying lens. Raynox 250, they call it. And that thing screws onto here, this adapter. And also slides into the front of the lens. Can extend, but now this gives me a shadow. So then I would have to use the overhead flash. But it does give you quite a bit of magnification. It's a good adapter. I use it more often. If you go to my website, all the list of my stuff is there.
What's the general setting for flash? I know because it's so close, right? Do you decrease the flash output by, is that general rule of thumb decreased by one stop, two stops, or?
In terms of flash power, one being the maximum power, I usually run anywhere between 1/2 power to 1/16 power. It depends a lot on the background where the insect is sitting on, and also depends on the color of the insect, some things of that nature.
And as far as taking the f-stop reading, and do you use the one with the camera, or do you use a spot meter of some sort?
No, I just take the picture and I look at it and it looks good or not. Yeah. Okay, now let me show you what I do for the microscope objective. So I got two microscope objectives. They're inexpensive ones. I know that the quality of the high technical focus stacks depends a lot on the quality of these lenses. Since I don't know how to do this too well, and I'm just learning, I decided I start with inexpensive lenses and work my way up to the more expensive stuff down the road, if I have a need to. I have a x4 microscope objective, and I have a x10 microscope objective. Now with this x4, I actually am able, if I'm rested, relaxed, and I'm propped correctly, I'm able to take good pictures of aphids outside.
Can you explain what is a microscope objective?
Well, in any microscope, you have a eyepiece, and you have the objective, that is the lens that is actually accepting the light from the subject. So this is just a regular microscope objective. It's a lens used by students in their microscopes or researchers. So this device would typically be connected to a microscope, not to a camera.
And where would you purchase something like that? What a vendor?
Edmund Optics is where I got this stuff from. They have a variety of nice stuff. So everything that I have to glue this microscope objective to the camera is from Edmund Optics. And it's not that expensive, relatively speaking.
And what is not expensive?
This is about $70.
$78.
It's not expensive. Like I said, relative to all the other stuff. I mean, some of these, like the people that do all these really, really good photography on focus stacks, they're using lenses that are $400, $500, $600 just
something that looks just like this. But the optics, the specification on the optics, the thing is when you get the magnification of this level, then now the magnification and the way that the light travels through this lens is not the same depending on the color of the light. So now you get a lot of artifacts on the image if you don't use really, really high quality lenses. So there's all kinds of specifications on how the light travels from here, comes out this way, and then hits your image sensor. You know, a lot of that stuff, I can't tell. My eyes are not that good, I guess.
Yeah.
You know, but some people can. You know. So anyway, so the question is, how do I get this guy to connect to this guy?
You know? Adapter.
Excuse me?
Adapter?
Yeah, I bought a bunch of adapters. Yeah, it is about adapters. Okay. What is the standard adapter name for the Nikon DSLRs? F-type? Okay. And there's a specification for that. Mm-hmm. So if your lens fits the F specification, it fits. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. I had to learn a lot about the different things that screw onto other things. It's a lot. Yeah, you have to do a lot of research to make sure you don't buy the wrong thing. Okay, so then I had to get an adapter that plugs into this F mount to what they call a T-mount. A T-mount is a 42 millimeter diameter ring. And it's this guy right here. It's got an F on this side and T on this side, which is the 42 millimeter ring. $25.
It's no lens.
Inexpensive, relatively speaking.
Yes. It's no lens, right? It's
no lens. Exactly. All I'm saying right now is adapters. Mm-hmm. Adapters, no lens. Ah. Now this micro lens won't fit there. But my ring now will. So, the same way that there is extension tubes for the F mount, which is this, there's extension tubes for that 42 T mount. So I just got some extension tubes. The other thing is, when I connect this stuff, this microscope stuff to this body, I don't have F stop anymore. What do I do with the F stop? There's no F-stop control anymore. Well, Edmund Scientific thought of that. And they sold me this manual F-stop. There you go. $60. It's not too bad. It may be a little bit more than $60, but you know, when you're really eager to get out in the field or do studio work, then you sacrifice a little bit. All right, so I'm going to connect that there, you know, and I don't remember where it goes what. I've experimented with in different orientations. So now I have my f-stop there, my extension tubes there, and and then here's an adapter that goes from the F, from the T, which is the 42 millimeter ring, to this is a C mount. And they use that in microscopy, uses C mounts. So that's a C and that's 28 millimeter. So now we got 28 millimeter that screws into the 42 adapter, which is this guy. And then that screws onto this guy. And now I got a microscope. Now, I know by experience that I really need to add a little bit of regular F-type extension tube over here. All right, there you go. And later on, I'm going to show you something about this. So that's how you put the microscope objective onto the camera. All right. So that's the stuff. I cannot use this in the field. This is only for using this little rig up I have here. Okay. My model's going to go to the side here for a minute before it gets damaged.
What's your depth of field with that?
Less than 1 millimeter. Well, with the times four, it's probably in the 1 millimeter range or less. Now we're talking about microns with the times 10. So that's why when you're using a times 10 microscope objective to do a focus stack, you have to take 200 pictures of a bug to be able to focus the entire bug at any one time. That's the drawback of that technique. It is very time consuming, and that's why I don't use it that much, but like I said before, I want to have that capability of doing that. So yeah, I know it does take a little research to come up with this, and it's a little bit more of an advanced technique. But remember what I said, 95 or above percent of my pictures are just the camera, the flash, and the micro lens. And you can take some amazing pictures just with that.